lesson this morning is from John 11, verses 1 to 45. It's the death of Lazarus. Now a certain man was ill, Lazarus of Bethany, the village of Mary and her sister Martha. Mary was the one who anointed the Lord with perfume and wiped his feet with her hair. Her brother Lazarus was ill, so the sisters sent a message to Jesus. Lord, he whom you love is ill. But when Jesus heard it, he said, this illness does not lead to death. Rather, it is for God's glory, so that the Son of God may be glorified through it. Accordingly, though Jesus loved Martha and her sister and Lazarus, after having heard that Lazarus was ill, he stayed 2 days longer in the place where he was. Then after this, he said to the disciples, let us go to Judea again. The disciples said to him, Rabbi, the Jews were just now trying to stone you, and are you going there again? Jesus answered, are there not 12 hours of daylight? Those who walk during the day do not stumble, because they see the light of this world. But those who walk at night stumble, because the light is not in them. After saying this, he told them, our friend Lazarus has fallen asleep, but I am going there to awaken him. The disciples said to him, Lord, if he has fallen asleep, he will be all right. Jesus, however, had been speaking about his death, but they thought that he was referring merely to sleep. Then Jesus told them plainly, Lazarus is dead. For your sake, I am glad I was not there, so that you may believe. But let us go to him. Thomas, who was called the twin, said to his fellow disciples, let us also go, that we may die with him. When Jesus arrived, he found that Lazarus had already been in the tomb 4 days. Now Bethany was near Jerusalem, 2 miles away, and many of the Jews had come to Martha and Mary to console them about their brother. When Martha heard that Jesus was coming, she went and met him while Mary stayed at home. Martha said to Jesus, Lord, if you had been here, my brother would not have died. But even now, I know that God will give you whatever you ask of him. Jesus said to her, your brother will rise again. Martha said to him, I know that he will rise again in the resurrection on the last day. Jesus said to her, I am the resurrection and the life. Those who believe in me, even though they die, will live. And everyone who lives and believes in me will never die. Do you believe this? She said to him, yes, Lord, I believe that you are the Messiah, the Son of God, the one coming into the world. When she had said this, she went back and called her sister Mary and told her privately, the teacher is here and is calling for you. And when she heard it, she got up quickly and went to him. Now Jesus had not yet come to the village, but was still at the place where Martha had met him. The Jews who were with her in the house, consoling her, saw Mary get up quickly and go out. They followed her because they thought she was going to the tomb to weep there. When Mary came where Jesus was and saw him, she knelt at his feet and said to him, Lord, if you had been here, my brother would not have died. When Jesus saw her weeping, and the Jews who came with her also weeping, he was greatly disturbed in spirit and deeply moved. He said, where have you laid him? They said to him, Lord, come and see. Jesus began to weep. So the Jews said, see how he loved him. But some of them said, could not he who opened the eyes of the blind man have kept this man from dying? Then Jesus, again greatly disturbed, came to the tomb. It was a cave, and a stone was lying against it. Jesus said, take away the stone. Martha, the sister of the dead man, said to him, Lord, already there is a stench because he has been dead 4 days. Jesus said to her, Did I not tell you that if you believed, you would see the glory of God? So they took away the stone, and Jesus looked upward and said, Father, I thank you for having heard me. I knew that you always hear me, but I have said this for the sake of the crowd standing here, so that they might believe that you sent me. When he had said this, he cried out with a loud voice, Lazarus, come out. The dead man came out, his hands and feet bound with strips of cloth, and his face wrapped in a cloth. Jesus said to them, Unbind him and let him go. Many of the Jews, therefore, who had come with Mary and had seen what Jesus did, believed in him. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Grace to you and peace from God, our Heavenly Father, and His Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. The Scripture boldly proclaims, the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ, our blessed Lord. Today's gospel lesson was 45 verses. Last week was 41. The amount of verses indicates the significance of the stories that's being brought to us in the Scripture. For John, in his Gospel, the 41-verse story of the healing of a man born blind indicated a pivot point in his understanding of who Jesus is. Jesus is the one who takes those who were once blind, and now they can see. Jesus takes the world from darkness and brings it into light. Similarly, the story of Lazarus is a pivot point in John's understanding of who Jesus is. The death and return to life of Lazarus is, in fact, the final sign in the story of the earthly ministry of Jesus Christ. It is doubly important because, unlike many of the miracles of Christ that are witnessed to in Scripture, this particular miracle is directed to those who stand in a close personal relationship with Jesus. Lazarus, Martha, Mary, they are his friends. For his friends, those who follow him, those who believe in him, those who support his ministry, for his friends, for such as us, we who are his friends, Jesus Christ tackles death. For St. John, the entire episode involves spiritual revelation. Jesus is, it seems, supernaturally aware of many of the events that are unfolding elsewhere. I wonder, in our lives, as we live our lives day in and day out, as we appraise the events of our lives, as we think about all the complexity of our lives, in addition to the hard facts and figures, do we ever pause and say, I wonder what is going on supernaturally in the realm of God behind all the things of our world? In this particular case, it seems that as Lazarus lays dying, Martha and Mary decide to send for the Master. The message that they send is a straightforward one. Notice there's no begging. Notice there's no imploring. The message to Jesus from these believers is simple and straightforward. Behold, he whom thou lovest is sick. St. Augustine, in his comments on this text, makes the point. It is simply enough to state the fact they offer no plea. They simply state the fact because they know to whom they are stating the fact. They know that Jesus knows. They know that Jesus understands. They know that Jesus loves them. They know to whom they send the message, to whom they send their prayer. Jesus knows. In our prayer lives, would we profit by remembering this? True faith in God necessitates no imploring, no hocus pocus, no jumping through hoops, no lighting candles, or facing east, west, north, or south. Faith hinges on words like, behold. Behold, he who thou lovest is sick. Faith hinges on phrases like, he or she whom thou lovest, knowing the love of God for us and those who believe in and follow Jesus, we can confidently entrust God with all the circumstances and with all the events and all the complexity that fills our lives. It is enough to say, behold, God. The passage tells us that Jesus loved Martha, her sister, and Lazarus. This love is sometimes profaned by the cinema world. It's sometimes portrayed in the temptation of Christ as something other than it truly is, because the word here is agape. It's love as a chosen attitude. It's intentional love, a moral course, a course that seeks the other person's good and exemplifies in demonstrable form your care about them. How many do you love this way? For whom would you send out the prayer, behold, he or she whom thou lovest is sick? By the time the message gets to Jesus, Lazarus was already dead. In some supernatural way, Jesus knew this, and he intentionally waits two additional days before going to Bethany. Timing. Timing is an important fact in this story. Jesus goes to Bethany because he loves Lazarus, wishes to demonstrate the glory and the power of God, and he is using this finale, as it were, to teach all humankind about resurrection. Jesus does not hurry, because Jesus knows that the third day is the time that in that culture you experience the height of grief. It was the day when in that culture it was understood that the spirit would finally give up the body and leave according to the ancient custom. Jesus selects this time as the very best time for the miracle that he is going to do. We who tend to rush in to life might want to think about this. We might want to pause sometimes and say, when is the right time to engage this matter, this challenge, this opportunity? Jesus then begins his travels back to Bethany, 2 miles from Jerusalem. It was a place where he had recently almost been stoned. He deliberately says, let us go to Judea. There's a subtle connotation in that. Let's go and deal with the Jews again. He doesn't say Bethany, he says Judea. Let's go to Judea. Let's go into that hostile land. Let's go into that land of unbelief. Let's go into the darkness, because the light of Christ shall certainly shine for those who Jesus loves. May we never forget that he's willing to place himself at risk for us. It is important that we remember that, especially when we're afraid, when we're disheartened. There's times when we feel so isolated and alone. Jesus is willing to put himself at risk for us. It is important that we remember this in our ministry. Ministry in Jesus' name is always a risk-taking, because the light is shining into the darkness. And so the disciples respond, "Let us go that we may be with him. Let us go that we might die with him. Let us go to Judea, the land of hostility and unbelief yet again." And they went to Bethany. Verse 20 is an interesting verse. Even though Lazarus was dead, even though he was in the grave, it still seems that watch is being kept for Jesus. Then Martha, as soon as she heard that Jesus was coming, went and met him. I wonder, in our spiritual lives, in our complexities and challenges, do we keep watch for Jesus? When things seem to have run their natural course, do we keep watch for Jesus? Even beyond the natural, all the way to the supernatural? This is what Martha did. She kept a watch out for Jesus. She was ready to respond. Mary was still in the chamber, crying and quivering. Where would we be with Martha watching for Jesus, or with John in our tears and our sorrow? Upon meeting Jesus, Martha gives a beautiful statement about her faith. She says, "Lord, if you had been here, my brother wouldn't have died. And now I know, whatever you ask of God, God will give it to you." Wow, a statement of faith in the face of death. Would we have such a kind of faith if we were in her position? We are so prone to not even trust God for the little things. Do we believe that whatever Jesus asks for, the Father gives him? Jesus tells Martha, he says to her, "Your brother will rise again." Jesus tells her that he is the resurrection and the life. Those who believe in him, even though they die, yet shall they live, and whoever lives and believes in him will never die. Wow. I love Martha's response to Jesus in verse 27. Even in her grief, she says, "Yes, Lord, I have believed. I have made this belief my own. I have believed. I have made this belief my own." Can you say that with Martha? Then they go to the grave, where Lazarus' body is, and the sadness overcomes Jesus. This gut-wrenching grief, this groaning in the spirit, this outburst of anger at death having the audacity to interfere with life. The antagonism and indignation of death overcomes Jesus. Jesus can't stand death. He allows himself to be very much, as we would say now, in the moment. He chooses his response, and this climax of natural grief calls him to real power. Not just powerful words, not just powerful preaching, but powerful acts. He wept, he prayed, he cried out. He cries out, "Lazarus, come forth." And Lazarus returns to life. Now we know he's calling his friend back to life. But at the same time, there is a subtle richness in this verse that could easily escape us, because the name Lazarus is a Greek form of the name in Hebrew, Eleazar. And Eleazar in the Greek, or in the Hebrew, is such a wonderful, wonderful word. It means God, Eli, Azar, our helper. What Jesus cries out is not just the name of his friend to come back to life and to come forth. Jesus is making his own declaration of faith. God, you are our helper. Now you come forth. People miss that. It is indeed a supernatural thing. Death calls for a supernatural response. Jesus is the resurrection and the life. Jesus appeals to his Father, who is indeed our helper in the midst of everything that challenges us, the greatest challenge of all being death. And there's little Martha saying, I believe. I have made this belief my own. Many believed that day. Do you? And in that land of darkness and hostility, still others went off to prepare the conspiracy that led to Jesus' death. They were so afraid of his power, it threatened their expected world. The world in which we live tells us you live and then you die. Faith and the supernatural perspective of Jesus Christ, who is our Redeemer, who is the resurrection and the life. Oh, what a powerful thing. Faith in Christ says, you live, you die, but you don't stay dead. You live eternally with Jesus. And to say that in the face of this world of antagonism and darkness, well, it involves perspective and trust, timing and love. It involves keeping watch for Jesus. It involves passion and indignation about death. It involves claiming Christ's power in your life. It involves remembering that our God is Eleazar. Our God is God, our help. All these are here in this climactic miracle of Jesus Christ, when Lazarus went from death to life. All this is here when Martha says, I believe, I have made this